Humans are fascinated by gore and violence, but even more so, the mysterious and unsolved. Interest in these disturbing and unpleasant subjects is called morbid curiosity, and it has gripped hundreds of people throughout the ages. I am one of those people. My name is Hallie, and this is the Morbid Curiosity Podcast. The sea hides many things. Things that have always been there, and things we have lost there. Over the course of human history, we have tried to reveal these secrets by mapping the coast from ships, diving in the shallows, using machines to dive to great depths. We have found many things, both natural, such as reefs, rifts, and underwater volcanoes, and things made by humans, such as shipwrecks and ancient structures that were taken back by the sea. One such secret was found in 1968, and its origin has been surrounded in mystery ever since its discovery. The Bimini Road, a line of huge stones just off the coast of the Bimini Islands in the Bahamas, has been associated with both fascinating geological processes as well as ancient myths of the lost city of Atlantis. In this episode, we seek to reveal some of its mysteries by way of the scientific method. The Bimini Islands are part of the Bahamas, a chain of islands just west of Florida in the United States. These islands sit on an elevated platform on the ocean floor called the Bahama Bank. The Bahama Bank is made of limestone that has been accumulating since the Cretaceous period, about 145 to 66 million years ago. The bank lifts the islands up from the ocean floor about 4.5 kilometers or 2.8 miles, with very steep slopes at the platform's borders. The water on top of the bank is quite shallow, staying about 25 meters or 80 feet deep. It was the Bahamas where Columbus landed when searching for an Atlantic route to Asia. There he met the Lucayan people, who greeted him peacefully. Soon after Columbus's arrival, all the Lucayan chiefdoms were enslaved by the Spanish, and their population decimated by foreign disease. Most of the archaeological material from their culture comes from Andros Island, the largest island in the Bahamas. The rock feature, known as the Bimini Road, lies about a half mile north of Paradise Point on North Bimini Island. Its location is not a secret, and anyone can dive in that area to look at it. Researching the area, however, requires a permit. The stones sit on a thin layer of sand on top of bedrock, meaning they sit almost directly on the ocean floor. The Bimini Road is made up of large blocks of stone, with lengths up to 10 to 13 feet, or 3 to 4 meters, with an average length of about 7 to 10 feet, or 2 to 3 meters. Most of the stones are shaped roughly like rectangles that have been worn down at the corners. The single layer of stones forms a line that goes northeast-southwest and then curves toward the shore at the southwest end, making the whole feature roughly J-shaped. The largest line is about a half mile long, or 0.8 kilometers, while the two smaller lines that lie closer to shore are around 160 to 200 feet, or 50 to 60 meters long. These smaller features are also made up of rectangular stones, but they're smaller, around 3 to 7 feet, or 1 to 2 meters, in average length. The line of stones is roughly parallel to shore, but not exactly. No ancient surface features, such as tool marks or inscriptions, have been recorded on the stones, and their rounded edges suggest that they have been worn down by the movement and chemical composition of the ocean. However, the modern humans of today have taken to chipping off pieces of the stone as souvenirs, so there are some modern tool marks on the stones. The stones are most often reported to be a type of beach rock, which is a sedimentary rock, meaning it is made up of bits of debris or sediment, in this case, marine shells, broken corals, and sand, that has cemented together over time. The process of cementation is complicated, But in summary, beach rock is usually cemented together by carbonate minerals when seawater evaporates during low tide and leaves these minerals behind, or when rain and seawater mix during low tide, or through microbacterial activity. Because of this process, beach rock usually forms parallel to the coast in intertidal zones, the zone where the tide goes in and out. Beach rock can form in as little as a few years through repeated exposure by low tides. It's a great indicator of the line to which the sea recedes at low tide, and can therefore be used by archaeologists, geologists, and environmental scientists to estimate past sea levels. During glacial periods, much of the water in the sea is frozen in glaciers, causing the sea levels to drop, while in interglacial periods, where the glaciers melt, the sea level rises. The last glacial period on Earth ended around 15,000 years ago. The beach rock of Bimini likely indicates that the Bahama Bank was dry land during that time, and the sea was around 120 meters, or 390 feet, lower than it is right now. Beach rock can form from anything, and beach rock that formed in the last few hundred years can contain human cultural material, such as glass bottles, pottery, and cut wood. This occurs especially if humans live near the coast where the beach rock forms. This is another way beach rock can give scientists insight into the past. It retains evidence of the presence of humans. The Bimini feature was first recorded by Joseph Valentine, a zoologist, in 1968. He described it as an extensive pavement of noticeably rounded stones of varying sizes and thicknesses, laying 5.5 meters, or 18 feet, beneath the water. The stones were mapped in further detail by David Zink, an English professor from Lamar University in Texas, between 1974 and 1979. Zink was an amateur archaeologist, but enlisted the help of professional archaeologists and geologists. The data he collected confirmed that there was a single layer of stones that lay roughly parallel to shore. He also noted the almost 90-degree turn at the end of the formation. Jay Gifford, a geologist, did extensive research and analysis of the stones and reported his research in his master's dissertation in 1973. He expanded on that research with an article that he wrote with M. Ball in 1980. Together, they measured and mapped the blocks and took samples to study their composition, confirming the stones to be made of beach rock. And now I've given you all the information that can be verified by published data in scientific and peer-reviewed journals. However, there is a lot more information about the Bimini Road that has not been published in mainstream archaeological and geological journals, and is in fact not accepted by these scientific communities. Because of the rough rectangular shape of the stones and their layout in almost a straight line, many people have wondered if the stones themselves might have been arranged by humans of the past. Some theories as to its origin are extreme, such as the belief that the stones are part of the lost city of Atlantis. But we'll get to those theories in a moment. First, let's have a word from our sponsors. Our regular sponsor is Audible.com. If you're always in the car, on the go, or just too busy to sit down and read, you can still enjoy a good book with Audible.com. There are over 180,000 audiobooks to choose from, which you can listen to on your iPhone, Android, Kindle, or other MP3 players. MCP listeners can get a free audiobook download and a 30-day free trial of Audible.com by going to www.audibletrial.com/MCP. You can also find this link on our Facebook page and our website. If you sign up for the free trial, you get a free audiobook that is yours to keep, even if you cancel the service, and the MCP gets the funding it needs to keep bringing morbid history to your ears. Our other sponsor is ThinkGeek, the premier retailer for the global geek community. Express your love of Deadpool, Rick and Morty, Dungeons and Dragons, Overwatch, God of War, and so much more with clever t-shirts and other unique apparel, home and office decor, electronics, collectibles, and more. ThinkGeek has great gifts whether you're into science or science fiction, and many of the items you won't find anywhere else. Just follow our link, bit.ly/morbidgeek, to search their massive collection of geeky gear. That's bit.ly/morbidgeek to get your geek on. Lastly, if you like this podcast, why not support or sponsor the MCP yourself by way of a donation? It takes a lot of time to research these topics, write a loose script, record, and then edit this show, all while keeping it free for you, the listener. When you donate, it helps us pay for research materials, and it keeps the lights on and the show free. If more people donate, we may even be able to eliminate the need for sponsors. That would mean no break in the middle of the show. If you'd like to help us out, head over to our website, www.morbidcuriositypodcast.com, and click the donate button. You can make a one-time donation or set up a monthly donation if you're feeling extra generous. Just $5 a month helps us out a lot, and it probably costs less than a large latte at your favorite coffee shop. It would almost be like buying me a coffee, which I would appreciate as I have a massive coffee addiction. I'd love to do this show for a living, and your donations, especially monthly ones, can help me make that dream a reality. I really, really appreciate your support. And now, back to the podcast. The controversy surrounding the stones can be summarized by a single question. Did the Bimini stones form naturally in place, or have they been altered somehow by humans? This is the most basic version of the question. It gets more complicated when we go into theories on who might have altered the stones. One of the theories most often publicized by television, films, and other entertainment media sources is that the stones were carved, placed, or otherwise part of the lost island of Atlantis. Atlantis was first mentioned in an allegory written by the Greek philosopher Plato on the hubris of powerful nations in 359 BCE. It appears in two of his works, Timaeus and Critias, and represents the enemy of a utopian version of Athens. In the story, Athens repels the Atlantean attack swiftly and effectively, thanks to its superiority as a state. Plato described Atlantis as larger than Libya and Asia put together, and ruled by Atlas, the son of the Greek god Poseidon. The story ends with Atlantis falling out of favor with the gods and sinking into the Atlantic Ocean, creating an impassable mud shoal in the middle of the sea. Although the story was only an allegory and played a very small part in Plato's works, the story of Atlantis inspired many other works of literature, especially the utopian works by several Renaissance writers such as Francis Bacon and Sir Thomas More. 19th century amateur scholars then misinterpreted Plato's narrative as a real history and took his vague descriptions, such as the date the island sank, which he stated was 9,000 years before his time, as a reference to a real event and location. Modern interpretations regarding Atlantis began in the 16th century, when scholars believed Atlantis might refer to the New World. These theories exploded when Europeans first came in contact with the ruins of the Mayan civilization in Central America and created both the apocalyptic and utopian versions of Atlantis that inspired later authors. Ignatius L. Donnelly's 1882 publication, Atlantis, the Antediluvian World, stimulated most popular interests in Atlantis. He was inspired by the previous theory that the Maya and all ancient civilizations were descended from Atlantis, which he described as being technologically advanced and socially sophisticated. He also believed the city was destroyed in the biblical Great Flood. His book is the reason that the myth of Atlantis and all the theories surrounding it still exist today. Today, the story still inspires many other works of fiction, including films, video games, and comic books. Despite the fact that historians and classicists, the people who study Greek and Roman classic literature, agree that Atlantis is fictional, there are still a lot of theories that assert it is a real place, and many explorers still search for its location beneath the Atlantic Ocean. Bimini has been drawn into the theory that Atlantis was a real place thanks to the belief that it is a remnant of the sunken island, and because well-known American self-proclaimed clairvoyant and Atlantis enthusiast Edgar Cayce predicted it was. This theory has been popularized by several television entertainment outlets, such as the Sci-Fi and History channels. Greg Little, a psychologist turned TV archaeologist, is one of the theory's most vocal supporters, believing the row of stones was once part of a wall or dock. He has yet to formally publish any evidence for his theories, but he has published critiques of several professional geologists' interpretations of the site. stating that any contradictions to their research is probably perceived as a direct threat to them professionally and psychologically. Another of the more outlandish yet well-circulated theories involves an ancient Chinese admiral named Zhang He reaching the Americas before Columbus and using/creating the Bimini Road as a dock. Gavin Menzies, a retired submarine lieutenant commander, asserts in his book 1421, The Year China Discovered the World, that during the Ming Dynasty, which lasted from 1368 to 1644 CE, Zhang He made it to the Americas. Menzies' theory is based on the notion that the year 1421 appears often in the history of the Forbidden City in Beijing, the former imperial palace. He concluded that it must have been an extraordinary year and began researching everything that happened in the world that year, focusing on Zhang He. Although the book contains many references, it lacks supporting evidence of Chinese voyages beyond East Africa. He states that his lack of evidence is due to Mandarin bureaucrats fearing the cost of further voyages, and therefore destroying the records of previous voyages to prevent future ones. The book sold well, but was heavily criticized by historians. A 2-hour PBS documentary was dedicated to debunking the theory with the help of Chinese historians. Their conclusion was that although the book is interesting, more evidence is needed to prove anything. They also stated that the book should not be regarded as historical, as no historical document or artifact has been found to support these claims. Other theories of origin for the stones include ancient Egyptian explorers, the Maya, and ancient aliens. These theories have not been accepted by mainstream archaeologists or geologists due to their outlandish nature and a severe lack of physical evidence. However, less outlandish theories have also been proposed. Numerous claims have been made for the presence of regular human activity in the Bahamas much earlier than previously thought. The archaeological sites that have been found in the area are generally Lucayan and consist of shell mittens, or heaps of empty seashells, basically a trash pile. These sites, however, only exist within the current boundaries of the islands and not in the water around them. If a site were to be found under the water, it would be an anomaly in itself, as the entire area around the islands has been underwater since at least 8,000 BCE, long before any cultures in the Americas reached a level of civilization that could organize to build large stone structures. Most geologists agree that the stones formed along an ancient shore from the last glacial period, when the Bahama Bank was above the water, which was around 15,000 years ago. Evidence for human activity in the Bahamas only goes back to 12,000 years ago, making it very unlikely humans could have built in that spot. If there were humans in that area, it's unlikely they had the technology to move stones of that size. And in the unlikely event they did have that technology, evidence of similar stone structures would exist on the Bahama Islands, and there are none. It's also unlikely the stones were arranged by humans, as there is no evidence of human material culture in the area surrounding the stones, at least none that has been well documented with contextual information. If there's one thing that humans always do, it's leave behind physical evidence of their existence, such as tools, middens, and other materials that were tossed away or lost during their occupation. A lack of human material culture makes it very unlikely that humans moved the stones or lived in the area. There are, however, several similar structures in other parts of the world that were used by humans, although the stones are not as big or as rectangular. Low stone lines have been found in the Menai Straits in northern Wales, along the Gwynedd and Anglesey coast. These lines of stone start on the shore, going perpendicular to it towards the water, then turn 90 degrees and become parallel to shore. These structures are naturally existing features on the beach which were enhanced, bolstered up so that they might be used to catch fish. High tide carried the fish over these stone lines, but when the tide went out, the fish were trapped. Humans then collected them. These are generally known as fish weirs, and they sit in the intertidal zone, just like the Bimini stones do. Many of these weirs were constructed in the medieval era, which went from the 5th to 15th century CE, and were submerged by rising sea levels. However, some were still in use into the 20th century. A similar situation arose in Greece, where natural harbors in the Mediterranean have been altered by humans to function better for their ships. The town of Eropetra, on the south coast of Crete, has been occupied since the Minoan period, between 2600 and 1100 BCE. In the harbor, a natural breakwater formed from beach rock and a small islet that was later built up by ancient occupants of the town so that it functioned more effectively. The fact that this natural structure was used by humans has not been missed by those who believe the same occurred in Bimini. The fact that it was the ancient Greeks who accomplished this has also been used as evidence by those who believe the Bimini stones to be part of Atlantis. Mainstream archaeologists, however, have determined that humans had no agency, or anything to do with, the placement or nature of the Bimini stones. This is based on a lack of human material culture around the site, as well as the fact that the Bimini stones have been underwater since long before human occupation began in the Bahamas. As to the idea that the Maya civilization might have created or moved the stones, their civilization did not start building monumental temples until around 2,700 years ago, so it's unlikely that they had anything to do with it, were they ever in the area, which is also unlikely. In addition to this lack of evidence of human activity, it has been shown that beach rock can fracture in this rectangular fashion on its own. This geological explanation has been the result of many investigations of the stones by professional geologists, archaeologists, and environmental scientists. As I mentioned earlier, Gifford studied the Bimini stones for his master's dissertation, and then later published a detailed article about them. He noted the shape of the stones, confirmed them as beach rock, and also confirmed a lack of human material culture in and around them. Eugene Shin, a geologist, also noted the lack of evidence for human presence near the stones and noted similar beach rock formations elsewhere in the Caribbean. He took core samples and x-rayed them, then compared them to cores from the surrounding area. The similarity between them caused him to conclude the stones had formed naturally and had also fractured into their current shapes naturally. He proposed that the stones had formed along an ancient shoreline, one from before the sea level rose. The J shape of the line, he stated, could be due to beach rock forming around a sand spit. In their analysis of the samples of the Bimini stones, Strasser and Davoud, geological professors from the University of Geneva, have estimated that the stones only formed around 2,800 years ago, from sediments on the Bahama bank that were around 4,000 years old. This occurred at some depth and beneath the North Bimini Island, creating a band of beach rock with thinner layers beneath it. As the sea levels rose, the shoreline eroded away, leaving the beach rock exposed by coastal erosion around 1,900 to 2,000 years ago. Then the loose sediment under the beach rock began to erode, all the way down to the limestone bedrock. As the loose sand and other sediment shifted out from underneath them, the weight of the stones and the fact that they are friable, meaning they break easily, cause them to fracture into the shapes they are now. This is called a scour and settling process, and has been documented in many instances of large, heavy objects sinking to the sea bottom. Several other examples of beach rock naturally fracturing in this way exist nearby, such as at Loggerhead Key in Dry Tortuga and at Pulley Ridge, both of which are in Florida. Other naturally angular rocks occur in many places across the globe. In Tasmania, which is south of Australia, what is called a tessellated pavement exists at Eagle Hawk Neck. The stones are almost exactly square. It seriously looks like a patio rising up out of the sea. At the Giant's Causeway in Northern Ireland, thousands of hexagonal rocks and columns line the coast thanks to an ancient volcanic eruption where lava cooled rapidly when it touched the sea, creating fractures that are nearly perfect hexagons, octagons, and other geometric shapes. This type of geometric column is also what makes up the Devil's Tower in North Dakota, which likely also formed from ancient volcanic activity. I'll post pictures of several of these on the Facebook page. They're all such amazing rock formations. I've been to the Giant's Causeway and the Devil's Tower, and it's amazing how geometrical the stones look. Despite this evidence of natural formation, controversy still surrounds the Bimini stones. In fact, the specific data we do have has been interpreted differently by the two groups. The rectangular shape of the blocks is often used as evidence by those who think the road was made by humans. However, mainstream archaeologists point to the shape of many of the other blocks in the feature, which are more random in shape, and the fact that these formations are found elsewhere as evidence that it is natural. The location and orientation of the line of stones, too, is interpreted differently, with mainstream archaeologists pointing out that it is roughly parallel to the beach, which is the way beach rock naturally forms. The other side points out that the line isn't exactly parallel, and the hook at the end is definitely not parallel, therefore it must be made by humans. Even the core samples that were taken for analysis are cause for controversy, with mainstream archaeologists pointing to the similarities between the cores from the blocks and the cores from the surrounding area as evidence that the blocks are natural, while the other side points out the differences in those cores to suggest that they are made by humans. Objective descriptions of the Bimini Formation are hard to come by as the area is already surrounded in controversy. Actual evidence is ignored in favor of outlandish explanation. It feels like the simple question of whether or not the stones and their formation are due to humans or not should be easy to answer, but somehow it has not been done to a degree where the answer is beyond any doubt. Unfortunately, past studies have had issues dating the blocks, and those researchers who want to do quality research on the stones are currently unable to get funding through credible institutions such as universities or geological societies, thanks to the site's reputation. The only funding available lies with popular media outlets that are more interested in the outlandish explanations. The reason researchers cannot get funding through credible institutions is because of the site's association with Atlantis and the other wild explanations. Professionals and professional institutions steer clear of the Bimini Road due to the fear that they will not be taken seriously or even be shunned by the rest of the scientific community. This halts all actual scientific research of the site, leaving it to those who don't have the experience or technology to do much other than repeat what has already been said, be it based on data or mythology. The polarization of the research community like this does not help further our knowledge about the stones. It also bolsters the stereotypes that scientists are elitists and that the general public do not value good data collection and analysis. In this age, when science is less and less trusted by many and politicized by others, it seems more useful to educate than to ridicule. This may not qualm all the outlandish claims, but it would assuage many and create a dialogue between amateurs and professionals that is sorely needed in this time of rapid information spread and data phobia. By working together, many more solutions can be achieved. Over the course of human history, we have sought to understand the world we live in. The ocean hides many secrets, but the secrets of the Bimini Formation are dropping away fast. Those that cling to the remnants of these secrets, the myth and the fantasy, may seem lost to those with the tools to reveal the truth, but the fact is, sometimes the mystery is more enjoyable. That is why these myths and the truth behind them bring out our curiosity. The Morbid Curiosity Podcast was produced by H. Lloyd. If you'd like to get in touch or suggest a morbid topic for me to talk about, you can tweet the show at Morbid Podcast or find us on Facebook and Instagram at Morbid Curiosity Podcast. If you like the show, please share us on social media and give us a rating on iTunes. Thank you to Dave, Bree, John, Jorge, Connor, and Allison for your comments on Facebook. Thank you to Holland for your comments on YouTube. And thank you to Emily for getting in touch on Twitter. Thank you to Lady Grey 3, D is Darkness, and 123 Fake Street for your reviews on iTunes. Thanks to you, the listeners, our creepy community is growing, especially on Facebook. So head over there to engage with other listeners and share your creepy stories and cute pet pictures. Also, the MCP is part of a wider creepy community known as the Belfry Podcast Network. Check out the other shows on the Belfry Network at www.thebelfry.rip. As I said before, if you like the show, why not support the MCP with a donation? Your gifts go to the research materials and other things we use to create this podcast, such as books and articles. It's also a great way to show your love for the show. If you'd like to donate, you can go to our website, www.morbidcuriositypodcast.com, and click the donation button. On our website, you'll also find links to all our social media, links to our sponsors, and other ways to contact us. We really appreciate your support. My name is Hallie, and until next time, thanks for listening.